Okay, so welcome to calculus. We're still in section 12.2. Which is annuities. So let's, I'll restart that example that we ended with. So the way it goes, what the example says is it says that $1,500 will be paid at the end of each year for 6 years. And it will be paid into an account with 8% annual interest which is compounded yearly. Now, that is a little bit unrealistic. First off, where do you have this 8% account? I'd like to know. And second, being compounded yearly, that's a little weird. Okay, that doesn't happen in real life. Essentially, everything is compounded monthly. But in order for this to be the type of annuity that we are discussing, what has to happen is that the payments and the compoundings have to happen at the same time. So since, you know, payments are occurring at the end of the year, that means that interest is also being reckoned at the end of the year. Okay, so payments and interest reckonings need to happen simultaneously for the type of annuity that we're dealing with. Okay, so then find the account balance at the end of the contract. Okay. So we'll divide this period of 6 years into years. Okay, so at time zero, you agree to make a payment at the end of the year. Okay, you agree to make a payment at the end of the year. So at this position, the account balance is zero because you agree to make payments at ends of years. So at the end of the first year, you take that zero balance and then you make a $1,500 payment. So everywhere in here, the account balance is zero. And everywhere in here, what's the account balance? 1,500. Okay, then at the end of the second year, you take that $1,500 that was you still have that $1,500 that was in there, and you make another $1,500 payment. However, this first $1,500 payment, because it was in the account for that whole year, that means that it has interest assessed against it. It has 8% interest. So then we need to multiply 1,500 by what? 1.08. And why 1? Right. It's 1,500 plus 1,500 times 0.08. Because you have 100% of this and another 8% of it. So that's 108%. Okay. So now, the next period, at the end of the next year, you have this first $1,500 payment, the second $1,500 payment, and a third $1,500 payment. Now, the first $1,500 payment, how long has it been in the account? 2 years. That means that interest is assessed against it twice. So we're going to have 1.08 and then multiply by 1.08 again. So this will be 1.08 squared, because it's been in there for 2 years. And this one will be 1.08, because now it's been in there for 1 year. And this one just got put in, so it doesn't have any interest assessed against it yet. Okay, at the end of the fourth year, we've got four $1,500 payments that have been made so far. Okay, how long has the first payment been in there? 3 years. So its interest against it is 1.08 cubed, and then the next one that occurred will have 1.08 squared, and then the next one that occurred is 1.08, because it's been in there for 1 year, so 1.08 to 1, if you like. And then this, well, this one just arrived, so it doesn't have any interest assessed against it. The next one. So at the end of the fifth year, there's been five $1,500 payments. Okay, I hope you're starting to see the pattern now. So the first payment, how many years has it been in there?
Four,
right? Always one less than the year number. So this would be 1.08 to 4, 1.08 to 3, 1.08 to 1.08 to 1. And then just to be cute, right, I could still write 1.08 for this new payment that just made it in, but what exponent would it have to have? 0, right? Because that's how many times interest has been assessed against it, 0 times. Okay. The last one. So at the end of the sixth year, there would have been six $1,500 payments. So how many, just counting the $1,500 and not reckoning interest at all, you know, if this was done with checks, what's the total value of all the checks? Not including any interest. 9,000, right? Because that's 6 multiplied by 1,500. So $9,000, okay, has changed hands. And then this first payment, well, that was bearing interest for 5 years, the next one for 4 years, the next one for 3 years, the next one for 2 years, the next one for 1 year, and then the last one just got in. Okay, so the account balance at the end of every year can be obtained by adding up these numbers, right? You could figure it out. So the answer that we're looking for is the sum of all these numbers. Okay? So that's the answer that we're looking for. So the answer we want is 1,500 plus 1,500 times 1.08 to 1 plus 1,500 times 1.08 to 2 plus dot 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 plus 1,500 times 1.08 to 5. And you could type that into the calculator, but that would be pretty tedious to do that. What I'd like for you to recognize is that adding this up, right, adding up these six terms, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, adding up these six terms, that's the sum of the first six terms of a geometric sequence, right? This is the sum of the first six terms of a geometric sequence. And if only we had some kind of formula about that. Wouldn't that be terrific? Oh, that'd be terrific. So given geometric sequence AN is A multiplied by R to N minus 1. So given that geometric sequence, the sum of the first k terms we denote as SK, and what's the formula for that?
It is A times RK minus 1 over R minus 1.
Yes, R to K minus 1 over R minus 1. Like so. So that's the sum of the first k terms. So in this exercise, in this particular exercise, what is A?
1500.
What is R?
8%.
Not quite.
Oh,
1.08.
Oh, 1.08.
In this exercise. And then what is K?
6.
So the answer to the exercise in the end, now that we've sort of worked it all out, you can see, it's this formula with A is 1500, R is 1.08, and K is 6. Okay, so let's type that in. Right, just this one. And we're never ever going to do it like this again, right? Because in about 5 minutes we're going to have a formula. But we've got to do it once, the tedious way. Okay. Okay, so I'm getting just over $11,000. So the answer is $11,003.89 when you round to the nearest cent. That is the sum in the account, the total in the account. So now I have a question. That's saying that the amount in the account is 11,000. How much total payments were made?
9,000.
So how did the 9,000 magically become 11,000?
Interest, right?
Now, I'd be sad if you got out of class and didn't understand what the interest means. Okay, so it's sort of in one way. It's exactly right to say that the reason why there's $11,000 is because there's interest, but it's also in another way completely uninformative. What is interest? Why is there such a thing as interest? What does it represent?
The bank paying you to hold your money, or the institute paying you to hold your money.
Okay, and why would they want to hold your money?
So they use it in other ways.
Right. Right. So what's happening is that, not to use too many technical terms, right? You're saying, okay, bank, I'm going to give you this money, and you can hold it, and you can do whatever you want while you hold it, and I won't request it, so you have exclusive access to this money. And that's inconvenient to me. And it's convenient to you because you're going to use it, and you're going to make money with it, so I want to cut. I want a cut of what you make. That's what interest is. Is you're saying, well, I have this resource, but I'm going to allow you to have exclusive access to it, and I won't use it. And what interest represents, it represents the convenience of one party and the inconvenience of the other. Okay, for exclusive access to a resource. Okay, so that's what interest really is. So any question about this example? Okay. Now, We are going to solve a lot of problems like that today. But we don't want to make this table every time. That would be no good. So let's just, now that we see the structure of the computation, let's come up with a formula. Do we? Well, you have a formula on that sheet.
Uh-huh.
But we haven't come up with it yet, right? No. Now you're getting me confused.
I'm really confused.
Oh, okay. I think you're thinking about, we have that r to k minus 1.
Uh-huh.
Right. But what is r and everything else? So we're going to use that formula, and we're going to come up with an easier one that has to do specifically with annuities and that terminology. Okay, so this is the amount of an annuity. And you can think of this more or less like a future value, which is to say, in the language of the previous exercise, right, we were making $1,500 payments at the end of a year for 6 years into an account bearing 8% interest compounded yearly. If we do that right now, how much money will be in the account at the end? 11,000 whatever. Okay, the future value. So suppose that we're making periodic payments of size R, big R, into an account with periodic interest rate I for N periods. Okay, the amount that will be in the annuity account at the end of this is going to be the following. So we're going to take this formula, SK is A multiplied by R to K minus 1 divided by R minus 1. So that's a formula that we know. And what is A? What are we going to substitute for A in this formula? Big R. What is going to be little r? Not I. Not in.
I.
Not I. So on the previous exercise, we were using 1.08.
I plus one.
So R is, and in the textbook and everywhere else, it's usually written 1 plus I, so I'm going to write it like that. And then what is K?
K is N.
Is N. When you substitute all those things in, you get this formula. You get R multiplied by 1 plus I to N minus 1 over 1 plus I minus 1. And it ends up being written as just an S. So I'm not forgetting to write the K. I'm telling you that the name for this value is S. Okay, and then only there's one little simplification that can be made. What is it?
The ones on the bottom, I.
Right. So S is big R multiplied by 1 plus I to N minus 1 and then divide by I. Okay, so this is a formula that you need to memorize. Sorry? Right, so then I agree that it doesn't exactly agree with our previous formula, but this is the way it's written. There's just no n. Okay, now this particular factor in round parentheses occurs with such frequency that it has its own notation. So S is R and then multiplied by, so I'm going to put a hat on this S to say that it's a capital S, because I suppose that adults wear hats or something. And then this is a little S, okay? And this is N, and then angle I. Okay, now, if I was to take this little symbol and blow it up so that you could see what I'm writing there, that would be little s in angle I.
So the n and the I are both subscripts?
Yes, they're both subscripts. Now, I'm never going to write that again. But I'm letting you know that because if you have a financial calculator, you probably have that button on your calculator. Okay, this does that. And if you read the textbook and you take your business courses and things like that, it's probably going to be written like this.
Do you think it's on my laptop too?
It might be. Yeah, it probably is. Yeah. But this, if you don't have this button, then this is what you do right here. Okay, good. So now, instead of what I'm saying is that this red box, okay, substitutes this whole reasoning here. Okay. Any question about this? So now let's do one. So I'm going to read. I'll read it aloud, and then we'll write down the important things. So an athlete feels that their playing career will last another 7 years. That's all they're going to be able to play their sport. To prepare for the future, athlete deposits $22,000 at the end of every year for 7 years. Into an account that is paying 8% compounded annually. How much will be in the account after at the end of 7 years? Okay, so you've got some athlete. You know, athletes usually have to retire from their sport pretty early, right? So like old soccer players are like, you know, 33. Wow, you're old to be playing soccer. So after 7 years, so for 7 years, going to make a deposit of $22,000 into an interest-bearing account, 8% compounded annually. How much will there be? Okay, so $22,000 payments. For 7 years. Years into 8% annual interest rate. Account, which compounds annually. So find the amount at the end. Okay, so then obviously, we're going to use that formula that's on the previous page. So that formula was S is equal to R multiplied by 1 plus I to N minus 1 divided by I. So we have this model, this annuity model. How many variables are in it? How many symbols? More than 3? 4, right? So the way it's going to work is you've got this model, and I'm going to ask you, every time I ask you a question, I must have given you all but one of them, right? That's the way it has to work. So which ones have I given you?
R, I, and N.
Okay, so what's R?
22,000.
Okay, 22,000. What is I? 108. 108. And then what is N?
7.
Okay, so plugging all those things in, that is 22,000 multiplied by 1.08 to 7 minus 1 divided by 0.08. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to evaluate that term in the parentheses. Okay, so then that term, that factor in the parentheses is 8.92280336. Okay, so you don't round until the end so you don't get messed up. So now I'd like to point out that how many payments are being made?
Seven.
Right, 7 payments are being made. So that means that, you know, if she does it with checks, okay, then she will have written 7 $22,000 checks. Okay, and if 7 times 22,000 is 154,000. So notice what this is saying. This is saying that if you make the deposits according to these terms, that is more or less like making 9 deposits of 22,000, isn't it? So you're making 4 deposits, 7 deposits, but because of the interest structure, it's more or less like making 8.9 payments. Okay. The reason for the discrepancy is the interest. So if you multiply that out, you get 196,301.67 to the nearest cent. Okay. Any question about this one? So notice that's another $40,000. Okay, and that's why, you know, all of the people around you who might be older, you know, your older relatives, parents, are saying you need to save your money. You need to go ahead and start. You need to do it now. Okay. Any question about this one? Okay, let's do another one. So now we're going to work the problem in reverse. We're going to say, okay, suppose that a child is born, your child, a nephew, someone, some child is born somewhere, and you've put it in your brain that you want to start an annuity for this child so that at the end of 18 years, when they reach the age of majority, they'll have $100,000. So what terms of an annuity would be necessary in order for the annuity balance to be $100,000 at the end of 18 years? So notice that this is different than the previous problem. The previous problem was that if you were paying this much, what would the total be? Now the question is going to be, we need the total to be such and such. Okay. So then you want to make, say, yearly payments yeah, or annual. I guess those mean the same thing. So yearly payments into, say, 7% annual interest rate. Account, which compounds annually, so that, this thing is bothering me, so that the account balance is 100,000 at 18 years. Okay, so I want you to find the monthly payment, or no, find the yearly payment. So again, the model is the same. This S is R multiplied by 1 plus I to N minus 1 over I. So what is it that we know and what is unknown? We need R. We need R, and we have everything else. So if we were to solve for R, that would be S divided by this crazy number, this crazy thing here, 1 plus I to N minus 1 over I. Okay, and what is S? 100,000, right? That's the target. What is I? Good. And what is N? Okay, so plug that in. And if you're not doing it, I suggest that you use your calculator in this lecture so that you can confirm or deny that you're able to do this here and now rather than during a quiz or something. So 33,999,03251. Okay. So 100,000 over about 34. Okay. So that's the number is 2941.26. So that's saying that, you know, suppose that you had a relative, a child or someone who was born and you wanted them to have $100,000 on their 18th birthday. Then you'd have to make, starting on their first birthday, you'd have to make payments of $2,900 essentially into a 7% interest-bearing account for the next 18 years. Okay, so any question about that? So how many payments would be made altogether? What is the total amount of payments is what I'm asking?
18.
Okay, so that's the count, but if you were to sum up all the payments, what would it be? It would be this number multiplied by 18, right?
Yeah.
That's how many checks, the sum of all the checks you'd write? Okay, so if you take that number and multiply by 18, my calculator is saying 53,000. So you would have written $53,000 in checks so that they would have $100,000 in the account. Okay, so that is more or less the way it works, is that if you have a normal interest-bearing account, on the order of 20 years, you can double your money. And really, that's not so excellent, because that's approximately what also happens to inflation, right? So, you know, if you had $100,000 right now, then in 20 years, and you just made a pile, right? Just you know, look at my pile of money. In 20 years, it would have half of the purchasing power that it does now. Okay, if you do nothing with it. Okay, so then that's why it's sort of ridiculous to listen to your old relatives and they say, "Well, I can remember when I bought a house for $14,000." Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, you lived, you know, three generations ago. Okay, it's been 60 years since you did that. Okay, it's not surprising. Okay, were you also fending off the dinosaurs? You know? Okay, or yeah, I'll buy it from you for $14,000 right now.
Buy your house for $14,000.
Yeah, that'll work real good. Silence. No. You know, or, well, when my first job, I made 37 cents an hour. Well, okay. Yeah, that was a long time ago. Okay. So the reason for that is inflation. And inflation, you know, a system such as ours purposefully has inflation in it. And there's a lot of reasons for it. But the mathematical reason for it is that it causes a lot of smoothing out of jumpy finances as time goes on. Okay, so now here's a separate question. What if, you know, if you wanted to have $100,000 in the account, you'd have to make yearly payments of $2,900. What if you just had a whole bunch of money and you didn't want to bother with the making yearly payments thing, and you just wanted to pay it all just right now? Just get out the checkbook and just write a check and put it into that same account. How much of a check would you have to write so that there would be $100,000 in the account at the end? So not, you wouldn't have to write that much. That'd be too much. Not 53,000. The reason why is because in the annuity scenario, you were making payments at different times. Payments were going later and later. So the bank wasn't holding on to all of the money all of the time. They were only holding on to some of the money some of the time. So only some of the money some of the time was accruing interest. So the question is, well, what if you just say, well, let's not do this. Let's just write a check right now.
Sell the hot dog stand.
Right. Good. So, you know, all that former stuff that we were doing, you know, when we were talking about hot dog stands and things, all of those calculations were, in a sense, completely unrealistic. Because, you know, we were saying, suppose you have an account with a continuously compounding interest. Okay, such accounts don't exist. Okay, but this, what we're doing, annuities, this is actually quite realistic. Okay, the majority of annuities are handled in more or less exactly this way. So this is quite realistic. Okay, so then...
Just not with that much interest.
Right, right. Just not with 7% interest. Right, it's usually going to be... Well, it'll usually be like maybe a point or more above inflation. You'll make a little bit of money over inflation, but not much. Okay? It's better than putting it under your mattress. I lost track. Oh, yeah. We want to know what is... So that formula that we were using, that's the future value of an annuity. How much will it be worth at the end, the future value? What we want to know is what is the present value? Okay. So this is a proposition about the present value. So suppose we have all those variables defined in their usual ways, R, N, and I. So R, N, and I defined as before. Which is to say that R is the amount of the periodic payment, N is the number of periods, and I is the periodic interest rate. So to diagram the situation so that we can all kind of have a model of what's going on. So just to make a picture, I'm going to say that there's four periods, but understand that in the formula I'm going to use N. So the way it works is we'll say, okay, at this position, the annuity account has zero, and then at this position we make a payment of how much? R. Let's write zero here and then R here. So R. Define R, comma N, comma I. Defined as before. Sorry, my handwriting is questionable today. Okay, then at this position, this first payment of R has now been through one interest period. So one interest is assessed against it. So it will need to be multiplied by what?
1 plus I.
1 plus I. Okay, and then now a second payment of size R is made. Okay, then here we have the first payment of R, the second payment of R, and the third payment of R. The first payment of R has now been in the account for two interest periods, so it gets 1 plus I squared. This one, 1 plus I to 1. And then at the last position, there have now been four payments of size R. The first one has had three interests assessed against it, so 1 plus I cubed. The next one, 1 plus I squared. The next one, 1 plus I to 1. And the last one just got there. Okay, so the sum of these numbers right here, that is the future value of the annuity. That's we have a formula for this. Okay, now we're asking a different question. We're saying, okay, what if you wanted to make a single payment P right here and then make no further payments? Okay, what would it take for interest to bear against P four times, 1, 2, 3, 4 times, and be the same as this? So at this position, interest would have bared against P once. So it would be one P multiplied by 1 plus I. At this position, interest would have been assessed against P twice. So 1 plus I squared at this position. Interest would have been assessed 3 times. And at this position, interest would have been assessed 4 times. Okay, so you can see the, hopefully visually, the two different scenarios. Right, this one has 4 payments made at different times. This one has a single payment made at the very beginning. And we want the final outcome to be the same. So what we have is we have P multiplied by 1 plus I to N. I know that the diagram says 4, but understand that means N. Is R multiplied by 1 plus I to N minus 1 over I. Okay, and we want to solve for P. Okay, so what do we need to do to solve for P? Okay, you can't subtract it. You have to divide it, right? Because this is product. So to get rid of it, you've got to divide. So now, dividing, so this is 1 plus I to N. Dividing by 1 plus I to N is the same as multiplying by 1 plus I to negative N, right? So just like dividing by 2 is the same as multiplying by half, 2 to negative 1. Okay, so this would be P is 1 plus I to negative N R 1 plus I to N minus 1 over I. Okay, now I'm going to commute the R and 1 plus I to negative N. Okay, now I'm going to take this 1 plus I to negative N inside into the numerator. Okay, and what will happen when we distribute into the square parentheses? So what about this 1 plus I to negative N multiplied by 1 plus I to positive N? What will that be? So it's the same base. 1 plus I is the base.
1.
Right. And when you're multiplying two things of the same base, what do you do with the exponents? You add them. So negative N plus N is 0. So what is 1 plus I to exponent 0? 1. Okay. So this will be R multiplied by 1 and then minus 1 plus I to, now I'm going to write this, I'm going to write this exponent in red because students so frequently get it wrong, to negative N. So that's different than the previous formula, right? So notice that this formula has the exponent is positive n, but this one is negative n. And this term, this factor in the round parentheses is also so common. So, okay, let's back up just a little bit. So this one right here is a formula that you need to memorize. Okay, and furthermore, this term in the round parentheses is so common that it also has its own special name and notation, but I don't know its name anyway. it is written as little a and then in angle I. Okay, and this might show up on my math lab or whatever that thing's called. And it'll probably show up in your business textbooks. And if you have a financial calculator, it might be on there too. But I'm not going to write it anymore. I'm just going to use this formula. All right, yeah. Well, this is a different one.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
This one says, this is little a. The other one was little s. Okay, so you don't need to know why this is, you need to know this is the formula. It would be excellent if you knew why it's the formula. This is why. But this is something you need to memorize. Any question about it before we do one? So now let's answer that question. Okay, we determined that if you want to have $100,000 at the end of 18 years, and you have access to a 7% annual interest account that's compounded annually, then you have to make payments of around $2,900 a year. Okay, now the question we want to ask is, well, what if you just wanted to make one payment right now at the beginning and be done with it? How much would you have to pay? Okay. So, for example, what is the present value of the annuity from the previous example? Okay. So what formula are we supposed to use?
The one that we just
did. Right, the one we just did. Okay. So the formula is P is R multiplied by 1 minus 1 plus I to negative N over I. And what do we know?
Aren't we solving for P?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So from the previous example, we know that I is 7%. We know that N is 18. And the question on the previous exercise was to determine R. So you've got to take your answer from the previous exercise. Okay, and that was. Yeah, that number.
2941.
Except I'm going to not round it. Oops. .2601.260166. Okay, so just plugging stuff in. So 2941.2260166, and then evaluating that factor in the parentheses. So that's 10.059.08. So now, before I type that into the calculator, I'd like to point out what that's saying. So we said from the previous exercise that how many times would we have to pay this amount? 18 times in order to have the desired outcome. But this is saying that if we were to pay it all right now, it would be like we only had to make the first 10 payments. Right? So the previous scenario is we're going to make that payment 18 times once a year. And this one is saying that, well, it would be like if you could just front it all the first 10 years exactly right now, then you'd be done. Okay. So taking that value, 2941. Okay, so then that is 29586.39 to the nearest cent. So would someone please put in plain words what this number means?
That's how much you have to deposit at the beginning of the 18 weeks to end up with the 100,000.
Right, the day they're born. Right. Write the check right now for 30,000.
Done.
Okay, and then you don't have to worry about making monthly payments. Well, it is definitely less money, right? So if you wrote out the checks yearly and you added up the checks, that'd be about 53,000. Okay, versus about 30,000 right now. The discrepancy is when you're giving the money, right? Perhaps it's inconvenient or impossible for you to write a $30,000 check just now. Okay. But if you could, okay, then that's all you'd have to write. Any question about this one? Okay, so let's mix it up. What are we looking for? Okay, so I'm gonna read a story out loud, and this is pretty realistic as to the way things really happen. Okay, so a used car costs $6,000. After a down payment of $1,000, the balance will be paid off in 36 months with interest. Find the amount of each payment. Okay, so this really is the way things usually occur. Is that you want to buy some large capital purchase, like for a car, and you don't have the value of the car available to you right now, so you make a down payment, right? So the car is $6,000, you can pay $1,000 now, and then you owe $5,000, and you're going to make payments on the $5,000, and your payments are going to go toward the principal. The $5,000 that you owe, and also the interest that you accrue as a result of not paying the entire balance in full at the beginning. Okay, so that is a very typical scenario. Yeah, you're going to end up paying more than $6,000 in exchange for being able to have the car right now. Right. So then, it's, you know. That's the trade, is that, well, I don't really have the six right now, but I really need a car. Okay, that's fine, we'll do that, but it's going to cost you. That's the way it works. Okay. What's going on here? Okay. So there's a $6,000 car. There's a $1,000 down payment. There's going to be monthly payments. For 36 months, That's a 1,000. For 36 months. And there's going to be 12% annual interest, which is compounded monthly. Okay. Not very good terms, but all right. So find the monthly payment. Okay, so we have two formulas. We have S is R multiplied by 1 plus I to N minus 1 over I. We have that formula. And we also, that's the future value. We also have the present value formula. P is R multiplied by 1 minus 1 plus I to negative N over I. Okay, I dotted my 1 there. That's nice. Okay, so we have two models. Each of them has 4 variables. Some of them they have in common, others not. Find the monthly payment. What are we looking for? Well, so what I'm asking is, we have two models, and the question says find the monthly payment. So which variable are we looking for? Are we looking for I? We're looking for R, right? So does everybody, I hope, understand that this instruction is saying find R? Okay, so both of those formulas have R. So with that information alone, it doesn't tell you which you're supposed to be using. So you're not able to tell. So because we want to find R, that means that we must have everything else, right? Because if we're going to use, if we want to find R and we have a model with 4 parameters in it, we must have the other 3, otherwise we couldn't find R. So do we have I? Yes, because the percentage rate is there. Okay, do we have N? Yes, we have N. Do we have S? We don't, right? We don't. S is the future value of the annuity. So let me ask, what if you went to the dealership and you made this deal yourself? Okay, the car is on sale for $6,000, and then you make a $1,000 payment. How much do you owe? You owe $5,000. What does that mean? That means that right now, if you gave me another $5,000, we'd be done. We'd close it out the contract. So what does that $5,000 represent? The present value. That's how much it costs right now to be finished. If you gave me $5,000 right now, we'd be done.
If you're not, then you have to pay
more. Right.
I don't know. I'm going to have to talk to my salesman.
So because you're buying something, okay, what you're talking about is the present value. So when you look at the sticker on the car, suppose you go to a no haggle place, so there's no haggling. So let's not have that. Yeah, that's a more advanced course. That sticker represents the present value of the car. You can walk away right now for that much money. Otherwise, you can put some money down, and depending on how much money down, we'll give you a loan for a certain interest rate, and you can pay it out in that way. So what this question is talking about, it's talking about present value. Okay, so we have present value. So the present value is P is equal to, well, the present value of the car is $6,000, but you made a $1,000 payment right now. So it's really the present value of the loan is $5,000. So now I hope that you see which formula are we supposed to use? The one with P in it, right? So now what is N? 36, because it's going to be monthly payments for 36 months. So N is 36. And what is I? So what is it? It's not. So 0.12, and then what? Divided by 12. Why divided by 12? Right, the annual interest rate is 12. But the payments and the interest accrual is occurring monthly. So the effective interest rate for the period is 0.01. One percent per month. Okay, so then, now it's just a matter of plugging in all the things, right? So R, the formula anyway, if you were to solve for R, would be P divided by 1 minus. Because it is a 12% annual interest rate. So it's 12% over the course of a year. But the payments and the interest reckoning are occurring monthly.
So if it was 7%, it would be?
7 over 12.
Okay, got it.
So 1 minus 1 plus I to negative N over I. Okay, so that would be 5,000 divided by that number. Divided by 30.1075. So that means that your car payment is $166.07. So, okay. Any question about that?
So the 1 plus I, that would be 1.01.
No, it's less than 1 is still positive. Right, so this number, 1 minus a very small number. So this number right here is going to be like, well, let's just type it out. So 1 minus 1.01 exponent negative 36. If I type just that thing that you were saying into my calculator, I get that number, 0.3, it's not negative. And then if I divide that number, if I divide that number by I, get 30.1. Are you typing negative 36?
I'm typing 1.01 to negative 36. It's 0.698.
1 minus that much.
Right, so 1 minus that much.
0.69. And then you divide it by 0.01 again, and that's how you get 30.
Right.
That shouldn't
matter because you're not using any trigonometric functions. So, I'm quite sure that this is right. But I'll be glad to help you figure out what's going on if you have a moment after. 166. So now, how many times are you going to make this payment? 36 times. So let's take that number. Let's take that 166 number, and let's multiply it by 36. Okay, and that number is 36 times 166. That's right at $6,000. So what you're saying is that, okay, this $6,000 car, I'll give you $1,000 now. And I will give you essentially $6,000 evenly spread over the next 36 months. So what is accounting for that?
The interest. Yeah.
Because what you're saying is you're going to the person who has the car, and you're saying, I really want to have that car right now, but I don't want to give you all that it's worth right now. And that person says, okay, yeah, we'll do that, but that's inconvenient for me, so it's going to cost you. Okay, and in the end, the cost turns out to be around $1,000 over the present value of the car. Yes?
So when you divide in the interest by 12, could you divide in the months instead? Or does it have to be the interest? Because it's just to get like the time slot, right? Because it's months and months.
No, it all has to be with the period.
Right, so that's what I'm saying. The reason for dividing by 12 is to make it the same period as the time.
So I think what you're asking, I think what you may be asking is I divided the interest by 12. Could you have instead of divided in by 12? And got it to still work? And the answer is no, it will not be the same. It has to be the interest, yeah. It has to be the interest because what has to be right is you have to line up where every payment is made. 36 payments are made. Okay. Yes? So the difference is, so what's happening is that, to make it simpler, on the first couple of exercises, what's going on here? To make it simpler on the first couple of exercises, we said that it was 7% annual interest compounded annually. So the fact that the interest was annual and the compounding was annual meant that we divided by 1. Right.
Okay.
And so if it was 20% interest compounded quarterly, then what would the effective interest rate be? You divide by 4. So it would be 5% interest per quarter. If it was, 60% interest compounded semi-annually, then it would be 30% per 6 months. That'd be some importance. Yeah, you got to not do that. Don't do it. Okay. Okay. So now, if you haven't gotten one of these sheets, please come get one, because we're going to use one now. So I need one. It's an amortization schedule. If that sounds exciting, then you might not be right. So, this is just a remark about jargon in the financial industry. So, a loan is said to be amortized when the principal and interest is paid off by sequential payments. Okay, so that means that for the previous exercise, the car loan of $5,000 was amortized by a sequential payment, a sequence of 36 payments of $166.07. Okay, so this procedure in the financial realm is called amortization. Okay. So that's just language. So this piece of paper we're gonna do in just a minute is filling out and doing a really boring computation, but we're gonna do it anyway. Okay. So then, here we go. Oh, I don't need this yet. So I'm gonna read a story out loud. And then we'll write down the important parts. Person agrees to pay $15,000 for a piece of land. Payments will be made twice each year for 4 years at an interest rate of 12%, which is compounded twice a year. So find the annual payment, or the periodic payment. Okay, so for example, so we have a $15,000 loan. So a person says, well, I want the land and I want it right now. Okay, that's fine. You can have it right now. Okay, but we're going to have to enter into this amortization agreement. So a $15,000 loan is going to have payments twice per year . It's going to have 12%. By the way, the reason why 12 always shows up in these exercises is because 12 is divisible by so many things, right? It's divisible by 2 and 3 and 4 and 6 and 12. Okay, so for twice per year, 12% annual interest, which is compounded twice per year. Did I miss anything? No. Okay, so then find the amount of each payment. So exercise one. Find amount of each payment. Okay, so we have two formulas currently. We have the future value formula, and we have the present value formula. Which one? So what variable are we trying to find? R, right? That is the periodic payment. And which formula are we using? The future value or the present value? Present value. So in plain language, why are we going to be using the present value formula? Right. Right now, that's how much the land, because the thing being bought in this story is land. The land is worth $15,000 right now. If you would give $15,000 right now, we could close out the deal and be done. Okay, so present value, that's the formula that we're using. Okay, it's future value when the story says something like, in 18 years, we want to have such and such monies. Okay? So, like lottery, when you do a $1 million lottery, if you were to win one, what you're going to receive $1 million of payments. That's how many checks you will receive. But you're going to receive payments, if unless you select the cash option, you're going to receive 20 payments of $50,000, because 20 times 50,000 is a million. Okay, is that right? No, that's not right, is it? Yes, that's right. You'll receive 20 payments of $50,000. Okay, now, if you take the cash option, then you'll get one lump sum and it'll be less than a million. What it will be is it will be the amount of money that you could take right now and put it into the same account that the lottery commission is putting it into, and then have $1 million at the end of 20 payments. Okay, so that's what the cash option actually is. So when you win the lottery, okay, it's actually what you're winning is an annuity. You're on the paying end of an annuity. Okay, so that's future value. Okay, the present value of the annuity is In fact, when you that's not even right. In fact, when you win the lotto, what you win is the total number of payments is going to total $1 million. Okay. The present value of the annuity, that's the cash option. That's what that really is. And it's always less than the nominal payout. Okay. So back to away from that false reality to this false reality. So find the amount of each payment. So we're going to use the formula R is P divided by 1 minus 1 plus I to negative N over I. Okay, so then what is the present value? 15,000. What is N? It's going to be 8. Why 8?
Because it's 2 times a year for 4 years.
Right. So 4 years multiplied by twice a year is 8 periods. And then what is the interest rate?
0.06.
Because it's 12%. Oops. Annual interest, but interest is going to be assessed twice a year, so the periodic interest rate is 0.06. Because it's 4 years, twice a year. So there's eight, so the interval is broken into 8 periods. Okay, plugging that all in. What's wrong with it?
It doesn't have 4 years.
Oh, I didn't ever say it. Oh, okay.
You didn't say it.
Okay.
You said it, but you didn't write it.
I said it out loud, but they didn't write it down. Okay, so where do I need to put it? Twice per year for 4 years. Okay, so then that value there. Okay, so then I'm getting that denominator to be 6.20979 blah blah blah. Okay, so then the value I'm getting is 2415.53914. Okay, so that's how much you'd have to pay every 6 months to have the land right now. It can be yours. Okay, any question about that? Okay, now here's an interesting question. And this is what the purpose of an amortization schedule is that, okay, for the first payment, how much went to interest only? Because understand the way this works is that when the contract begins, you now have exclusive access to this property. Okay, and the person that formerly had it didn't receive anything yet. So you're paying interest for that. So at the date of the first payment is when the first interest is assessed. So you make a payment, and at the same time interest is assessed and added to the principal, and then your payment subtracts from the principal. So how much of your payment went to interest only is the question.
So you do 15,000 right times when assessed.
Right there, for only the first payment.
Or you do 15,000 times 1.06.
Well, just times 0.06 would be how much interest was added.
Oh, right, so that would just be, and then you would subtract that from that.
Right. So remember that the simple interest formula is big I is equal to PRT. So in our formula, in our case, that would be just P multiplied by I multiplied by 1, because it's just one period. And if you multiply that out, that is 15,000 times 6% is 900. So that means that for the first period, just for the pleasure of being in control of that property, it costs you $900. Just for the pleasure of being in control and not having paid anything yet. Okay, so then how much now for the first payment? And how much went to the principal? So what was the total payment?
2415.
Right, this number, about 2400. And then what was the what went directly to the interest? 900. So the part that went to principal is the difference. So that would be R minus this 900, which is 1515.53914. That's a little bit disturbing, isn't it? You mean I just made a $2,400 payment, but my balance only went down $1,500? Wow.
Yeah, I was like, well, adulting.
Well, yeah, welcome to being an adult. Okay. And then, right.
Or like, when you make your mortgage payment, that's just like, oh, I'm only paying like $200 on my house. Horrible.
Yeah. Okay, so, and what is the current, after this first payment, what is the current unpaid principal? Right. $15,000 minus this much. Okay. $13,484. .46 something. Okay, now, so I asked you these three questions. For the first payment, how much went to interest? How much went to principal? How much is still owed? So now I could say, well, what about for the second payment?
Just do it all over.
And then we'll do it all again. And then how much for the third and the fourth and all the way to the eighth payment? And when you make such a table of all those values, this is called an amortization table. And now we're going to do that.
Oh,
don't have to. Oh, we're going to do it.
We were just talking about how much you like to look at that.
So I made this. I typed this up today.
Beautiful. You
shouldn't
have.
You should. Yeah, you're probably right. Okay, so let's fill it out. Okay, so how much is being amortized?
Oh, are we going to do the same problem?
Yeah, same problem.
Oh, $15,000.
$15,000. The periodic interest rate?
0.06.
The number of periods? 8, so we won't use every row.
It's like L under 12.
And then the periodic payment was that number that we did in the first place, 2415.53914.
But you pay in full cents, you don't pay in fractions of cents.
I agree, but we just don't want to round until the end, right?
But when you make a payment, you're not going to be making 24, 15, 50.
Okay, I do agree with that.
And 9/10 of the cent.
I do agree with that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I wonder, like, what would happen if you wrote that on a check?
You pay it at gas stations, though.
Oh, right, yeah. Exactly.
53914.
Yeah, 2415, yeah. That's from the previous page.
Say boo. Like, you can't do it that way.
Is that what happens? Like, will they reject your check?
I think the bank would say.
We round up just like everybody else would.
Okay.
No one has actually ever done that, and that's just how I've handled it.
Okay.
I mean, it's just, again, it just gets adjusted out at the very end. Like, at the very last payment, it just might be less because...
Okay.
I'm just...
Right, you're right. That is the way it works. You're right.
I'm saying you don't pay.
Okay, so this first column, the way that you evaluate this first column is that this is the formula X times R. So this is the X value, so 0 times R, so that the total payment at the beginning is $0, right? So 2415.53914, and then we're going to do 1 times this. So yes, okay, I'll round to the nearest cent, 2415.54. Okay, then after two payments, we will have paid 4831.08. After three payments, 7246.62. After four payments, 2662.16. One, two, zero, seven, seven point 70. This is exactly as boring as it looks. No, I don't want to say that because some people like this.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, okay. Accountants are people too.
So I have a cool spreadsheet at work that I just put all this info in.
Right, and that's the other thing, is that no one ever does this by hand.
No.
Where all the other stuff we've done this
semester?
Well, so...
That's true.
Okay, yeah, it's true, but the point
you
of the...
You can argue his point.
Of the thing...
Critical thinking.
Critical thinking.
You can argue his point right now, guys.
How about...
Yeah, do we have a joke?
I spent a lot of time today looking at other programs and thinking about writing a book.
Yeah? Okay, well.
When I should have been doing my homework.
Okay. So what the meaning of this column is that by the end of the contract, how much will you have paid?
$19,300.
About $19,000. Okay. So... But I thought it cost $15,000.
Yeah.
Ah, right. You're going to end up paying that extra $4,300 because you're so kind. No, because that's the cost of you obtaining access, exclusive access to this property immediately, right now. Okay. So then this next column is exactly the same as the previous column, except in the reverse order. So zero.
But are we seeing the interest is charged all the time? If they paid off early, they wouldn't pay as much interest, right?
Okay, that's a real life thing that's not happening here. but yes.
We don't believe in real life things in this class.
Yes. That's not critical. Okay. This is imaginary.
That's not critical thinking. Yeah, I like that.
Real life is critical thinking, guys.
Nobody pays off anything early. Now that is actually more accurate.
If I get to the end of it, I'm like, I just got to be done.
Okay, so what's someone tell me what's true about these two columns besides they're in reverse order? So there's something about these numbers.
When you add up each row, it equals
the total amount, right? Because it's the total payment and what remains to be paid. Right, so the sum of any pair of these is the total amount. Okay, so now the principal that is yet to be paid. Okay, we found this one has to be 15,000, right? Because no payments have been made, and we worked pretty hard to find the 13,000 or whatever number on the previous page. Okay, but there's actually a formula for this. Okay, so I'm not going to go over the derivation of the formula. I'll just tell you that here it is. Okay, but we could, right? But it's just we have so many things to do. So here's a formula. So now this formula has even one more variable in it. It has X. Okay, and X is this column number right here. That's how many payments have been made. Okay, so then lots of variables in that one. So let's do it. So let me ask, is your question, are you going to fill out an amortization schedule on the exam?
No. My question is, do I need to know the principal and paid after X?
Yes, you need to know this formula. Yes, you need to know all three of these formulas. Because it's...
Don't cry.
I have given you the formula. Okay, so let's start doing the formula. Yes, you need to know these things. No, what's really good is to go into a loan situation with a calculator and know these formulas and say, wait a minute, I'm going to check that.
Hey, you never know, like, where there might be an extra fee that they're popping in there and telling you
it's yeah.
No, I don't sell. Our fees have to be... I think that it's actually, it's a lot to do that. I think the fees have to be explicit.
Yeah.
I lost track of my... Okay, so I just determined that this number is 15,000. Okay, good. Okay, but now that I have it typed in, it's easy.
Wait, how are you typing it in? Wait, am I going to need to type it in?
Yes. I mean, you're going to have to type this into a calculator somehow. So the way that it's typed in is like this. The way that I'm doing this formula is I'm typing 2415.53914 multiplied by, in parentheses, 1 minus 1.06 caret negative, and then 8 minus, and one of them is going to be like 4, so that would be when x is 4. And then close, divide, 0.06. So that's what I'm typing into my calculator. And I'm, for every row, I'm going to change that green number.
Can you tell me? Oh, every row you change every number. So on payment 1, it's a 1?
Right.
Got it. Payment 4 is a 4.
Right.
Got it. Thanks.
And
re-enter each time, there's not a button.
Right. So if you want to see what I'm doing on my calculator, I have this thing typed in, so now I want to get payment 1. So I come over to here and I change that to a 1. It's currently a 1. Okay, so now I'll make it a 1. Okay, then that's the payment. So 13484.46. Of course, the other thing is you could just type this into a spreadsheet. One one 8.77.99.
So we're not gonna have to make a table.
Not on a quiz, but I'm gonna give you a homework exercise. There's not enough time to do this on a quiz.
Yeah.
And besides that, you know, if I gave a question like this, someone would just say, "You're gonna drop one, right?" Yeah, I'm a drop.
I know which one.
That would be me. Actually, I might just sit there. No, we're saying it's a huge
Ten? Right, no.
Okay.
So it makes it slightly tolerable. Oh, wow. You know, before the advent of computers, there used to be people who their professional name literally was computer. And they
computed.
They computed. They did this more or less.
Hey, you know what? There are lots of ways to be a nerd that have nothing to do with math or orange.
Okay, and then the last unpaid has got to be zero. Okay. Okay, two more columns to go.
But that's a pretty big discrepancy, actually, that number, the 22780. Oh, that's principal unpaid. Just kidding. We're still paying interest on it.
Right.
I'm like, how is that? I get it now.
So, right. So this number right here, the number that needs to go right here is the previous Q multiplied by the interest. So you use the previous Q and then you multiply by the interest. Now on the previous page, we determined this number to be what?
900.
900. Okay. So this is 900. Okay, so 900.
Wait, can't you calculate payment? Oh, never mind, minus. Can you show me again how you're calculating that?
How I'm doing this?
Yes. Yeah. With the
calculator? I'm doing this formula. And since I'm on row two, I'm using one, because it's the previous one, and then I'm multiplying by 0.06. So it's
multiplying it with 0.06.
Yeah, because it's QI.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so notice the payments going to interest. What's happening to them?
Going down.
They're going down. Why is it that the payments going to interest are going down?
Because there's less money to pay interest.
Exactly, because there's less money, there's less principal unpaid. So you have this fixed payment amount of around $2,400. The principal is going down. So every time you make a payment, more and more as a fraction of that payment is going toward the principal. Well, yeah.
I'm giving you a hard time. I get it, you don't have a choice.
For some reason, my brain can't comprehend. Oh, I got it.
So, notice that on the first payment, $900 went to interest. $900 went to interest. And on the last payment, $137 went to interest. Okay, now, as it turns out, this unfortunately is entirely realistic. Okay, because if you... You know, if and when, or maybe already, you have a mortgage payment, it might make you sick to look at the amortization schedule of your mortgage, you know, because, you know, you might be saying, oh, I'm going to pay $2,000 a month. And then you look at it, and then you realize $1,200 of that is going to interest?
The best part is your year-to-date statement that shows how much principal you've paid versus how much interest you've paid.
Yeah. It's terrible.
It's awful.
Okay, so then now, how do you get this column?
You subtract the payment minus the interest.
Yeah, so it's 24, whatever, 24, 15, 50, whatever, minus this much.
I've got some of them if you want
to. That's okay, I'll do it here.
He's having fun.
He's having a blast.
Oh, yes. Okay, so 2278.81.
So somebody had to put these kind of, like, because Excel can do this.
Yes.
So somebody still had to figure out how to do it in Excel, right? Like.
Well, yes and no, because it depends on what you're talking about, because today, we literally derived this formula and this formula, and we could have done this one, but I'm just going to omit it.
Thank you.
So we've literally done it, okay, essentially all the work. Now, you might be talking about, okay, well, someone had to actually program, had to write the source code for that program. Okay, yeah. Yeah, we didn't do that today.
That's a different class.
Yeah, that's a different class. But all of these formulas for amortization of assets and debts and things like this, this was all common knowledge well before
right.
Excel ever existed.
Because there were loans before there was Excel.
Yeah. Okay, now, what has to be true about these columns right here? Yeah, they have to add up to the payment. Oh, I know what this one is. Okay, so we did it. We made an amortization schedule with just 8 payments, right? Imagine if you were paying off a house, you know, with a 30-year mortgage, you know. So that's, what, 360 payments or something like this? So wouldn't that be fun, right?
I'll be right back. There was a fire.
Yeah. So.
All my friends are jealous that I have a house. I'm like, no, I don't think you can. There's nothing to be jealous about.
I wasn't talking about the house. I'm at the office that kept all this stuff.
Right, yeah. Okay, so you've done it. Now, part of the reason that I wanted you to do this is just so you could get accustomed to doing these formulas, but also just generally as a public service announcement to you about amortization, and that is that when you buy a large asset, it is truly, truly in your interest to pay as much down as possible so that you have less principal with interest accruing against it. And it is truly, truly in your interest for that's funny, isn't it? In your interest to be making your payments as big as possible.
That's not always true.
If you can afford it, if it doesn't affect
what
your...
But what if you can invest your money in a higher interest rate and make a higher interest rate on your money?
It's then, almost impossible.
Then you've established arbitrage and you can't, it'll never happen.
Okay.
If you can make money, if you have a means to make money that's better than your mortgage,
yes.
Then you shouldn't even be in this room. That's what you should be doing. That. Then you should be off doing that, and you should be buying houses and selling them, and making the arbitrage difference.
Yeah. Don't some of the loans have penalties for paying on 2,000?
Some
They did, but I believe that that's now illegal.
Okay. Oh, I didn't know that.
Now they just have variable rates.
So it's probably a good place to stop.
No, no, we've got to keep going.
No.
But we're just going to, we're
I'm
just.
I'm like, we're going to start in the next
joke.
8 minutes.
<Got a joke. laughs>
I mean, really.
We're just going to introduce a topic, and then we'll leave. Right. There, we will have no more introductions of topics on Thursdays. This is the last one?
We're going to need some jokes.
Going to need some jokes. Okay. I'm going to have to think about that. So this is called Infinite Series. Oh, I already have one. But it's going to take a minute. In fact, the joke requires so much setup that I won't be able to do it today. We'll have to do it on Tuesday.
You've got to write it down so you can remember.
Yeah, so don't forget.
You just showed us amortization. That's pretty funny.
Pretty funny already.
Tragic.
Okay, so then here we go. What the topic is about is it's called Infinite Series. So formerly, we were taking sequences, geometric sequences, and we have a formula for the sum of the first k terms of a geometric sequence. Okay, that's what we did last class. So, given a geometric sequence, you could ask, or just any sequence, can you add up all the numbers? Well, what would happen if you tried to add up all of the infinitely many numbers in a sequence? Because after all, a sequence can be reckoned as like a list of infinitely many numbers. So what if you had the following sequence that was zero at every term? So the first term is zero, the second term is zero, the millionth term is zero, they're all zero. What's the sum of all the terms in that sequence?
Zero.
Okay, what if you had the sequence where the first term was one, the second term was one, the millionth term was one, they're all one. And you try and add up all those, what do you get?
Infinity.
Right, you can't add them all up. Okay, so if they were all zero, it would work. If they're all one, it wouldn't work. Okay, is there any case where you can have a sequence and not all of the numbers are zero, where you can nevertheless still add them up?
Because if they were really, really small.
Well, what if you added, is 0.1 small?
No.
Okay, then what's small?
I mean, I guess like 100, not
so
even.
So 0.01?
Yeah, I guess infinitely it would still be. Infinity.
Yeah, it's still infinite.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm gonna show you something that requires infinitely many numbers, but nevertheless adds up into something finite. Okay, in fact, let's do it on the paper, so it's on camera. So imagine that this was some distance that we were really interested in. And I could say, okay, I'm going to start here. And then I'm going to move half of the remaining distance to the end. Yeah, we did. Okay, so then now, so we've made it, whatever this is, we could call this 1.
So sequentially by half would be?
Yes. If we always proceed half of the remaining distance, okay, then notice that after any finite sequence of steps, we will still be less than this total distance. We won't have made it. But what happens after infinitely many steps? Where will we be? We'll be there at that position.
Yeah.
We couldn't have passed it, because if we passed it, that would have mean that somewhere at some step, we wouldn't have followed the instruction, only travel half of the remaining distance.
So you do reach it.
You, after infinitely many steps, you are there.
So, okay. So you don't ever reach it. I don't want to talk about it. It just makes you crazy. It
makes you crazy.
It does. You think about something that you just can't define.
Well, that's literally what calculus is. Calculus is the thought experiment that what do you get when you take algebra and you allow there to be either infinitely many numbers or finitely many numbers upon which you're going to perform infinitely many operations, or you're going to have infinitely many numbers and infinitely many operations. That's
shocking that I hate calculus.
That's literally what calculus is. So, here we go. This is the definition of an infinite series. Suppose that we are given a sequence AN. Okay, and a sequence is reckoned at, you can conceptually think about it like a list of numbers. Here's the first one, here's the second one, here's the millionth one. Okay, so given a sequence AN, the sum of all terms in AN, A1 plus A2 plus A3 plus dot, 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 all the way to the end, is denoted in this way. So sum from I is 1 to infinity of AI. So that's sigma notation, right? And notice that the top limit is infinite. So this is called the infinite series. Infinite series. It is defined in the following way. So the sum from I is 1 to infinity of AI is defined as the limit as k goes to infinity of the sum from I is 1 to k of AI. So what that means is that you're going to take A1 plus A2 plus dot, dot, dot to AK. So a finite sum. So I hope this definition reminds you of something that we've done already. What does this remind you of anything that we've done already? What kind of integral? I'm fishing improper integrals, right? Remember what it means for an integral to be improper. It means that the region that the integral describes is not bounded. You cannot draw a circle around it. So what was our technique to deal with such regions?
Oh yeah, you have to divide it by constant.
Yeah, we cut it at a certain position.
Oh no.
And then you can draw a circle around it. So you integrate, say, from 0 to b instead of 0 to infinity. And then what? B goes to infinity. It's the same thing here. Instead of trying to sum up the whole sequence, we'll sum to k. And then we'll let k go to infinity. And when this limit converges, the series is said to converge. Okay, so the last thing I want to say is that there's something unfortunate about this, and that is we have two kinds of objects now. And if I could go back and change it, I would make one of them not start with S. Okay? Sequence and series. Unfortunately, they both start with S and they even sound similar and they're intimately related. So, sequence is a list of numbers. The first one, the second one, the third one, etc. What is a series? The sum of all the terms in the list. Okay, so, and that sum may converge or it may not. Okay, so sequence, list.
No one uses series. Series,
right?
Well, no, unless they're talking about this specific mathematical object. Yeah.
So you're changing the definition of series?
So have a nice